I'm up. I'm up. I'm up. I'm up. So I should do some engineering.
There are a few ways to add mechanical motion to our project. Electric motors are an obvious choice, but they just spin rapidly with little regard to position. If we want to be able to choose a precise position, say for pulling a chain, then we'll need something like a servo motor. To help me wake up in the mornings, I've attached a servo motor to this lamp. Whenever my alarm fails, the servo just pulls this chain and I get a burst of light in my eyes. Before we look at servo motors, let's look at how a DC electric motor works. An electric motor is made up of a few basic parts. The stator is all the stationary pieces, which consist of the casing and two or more permanent magnets. The rotor contains a set of conductive wires wrapped around some type of core. Whenever electricity flows through these windings, the cores turn into electromagnets, as the flowing electricity produces a magnetic field. This causes the ends of the rotor to be attracted to or repelled from the permanent magnets, depending on the polarity. The rotor is attached to an axle. This is normally a rod that spins along with the rotor, and it gives us our rotational motion that we can attach wheels, fans, and gears to. We run into issues when the rotor reaches the maximum extent of its attractive forces. There's nothing causing the rotor to be repelled when its ends are closest to the permanent magnets. To fix that, we can either use an alternating current or use a commutator. The commutator is simply a few strips of metal that connect the wrapped wires on the rotor to our power source, such as a battery. Electricity flows from our power source, through the contacts, through the commutator, then through the windings, back through the commutator on the opposite contact to return to the power source. As the axle spins, the commutator spins with it. When the rotor reaches the extent of maximum attractive force, the commutator switches which contacts it's touching. As a result, electricity begins flowing in the opposite direction, causing the attractive forces to switch over into repulsive forces. This keeps the motor turning. When we apply a direct current, say from a few batteries, the motor begins to spin, usually quite rapidly. Electric motors are great for getting a spinning motion, but they don't allow us to set an exact position. To do that, we'll need to add in a few extra components to make a servo motor. A servo usually looks like a box with an axle and some wires. To see how it works, let's take a look inside the box. Under the casing, we find an electric motor. We've already seen how these work. These gears slow down the rotational speed from the motor and give us more torque on the shaft. This interesting component is a potentiometer. Let's talk about how potentiometers work. A potentiometer is a type of resistor. As you turn the potentiometer, it changes the amount of resistance between two of the terminals. So, as the gears turn from the motor, they rotate the potentiometer, which changes the resistance. A controller board measures the amount of resistance from the potentiometer and rotates the motor as necessary to reach the desired resistance. Most servos have three wires. One wire is power, one wire is ground, and these two give power to the whole system. The third wire is the signal wire. We tell the servo to move to a particular position by sending information over this wire. The controller board rotates the motor just enough to match the desired resistance from the potentiometer and then holds that position. Now that we've seen how servos work, let's make one work with our micro bit. For this demo, we'll need our micro bit, three alligator clip wires, three jumper wires, and a servo. Unfortunately, the wire colors differ among the various servo makers. White, orange, and yellow will almost always be the signal wire, so let's put a white wire in that. The middle wire is usually the power pin, so we'll put a red wire there. The last pin is then ground, so we'll connect a black wire into that. Using alligator clips, connect the power wire to the 3-volt pin on the micro bit, connect the ground wire to GND, and connect the signal wire to pin 0. In make code, drag two on button pressed blocks to the work area. Change one to button B. MakeCode has some great built-in servo blocks, but we need to enable them. Under Advanced, click on Extensions and click on the Servo extension. you should see a servo category appear. Click on it and drag a set servo block to underneath button A pressed. Drag another to button B. We'll keep pin P0 selected as that's where we've connected our servo's signal wire. Change the first position from 90 degrees to 30 degrees. If you're looking at the servo, this will set the shaft to 30 degrees from its most counterclockwise position. Most servos can only turn a maximum of 180 degrees, which would have the arm pointing in the opposite direction from its 0 degrees position. Change the next value to 180 degrees, which will move the servo to its most clockwise position. Try pressing buttons A and B on the simulation to see how the servo moves to the desired position. Download and copy your code to the microbit. Press the A button and the servo will rotate to one position. Press the B button and the servo will rotate to another position and stay there. Most servos come with a number of attachment arms, which you can fix to the servo's axle with a screw. These lever arms let you attach other mechanical components that you want to control. With the lever arm, we can see how the servo will rotate to about 30 degrees with the A button and to about 180 degrees with the B button, just like we set in code. Unfortunately, the microbit is sometimes not able to provide enough power to servos. You might see them stutter, jump, or not work at all. This is especially true if you try to control more than one at a time. If this happens to you, then you will probably need to invest in a servo controller board that lets you control multiple servos from your microbit. Servos can be found in all sorts of applications, such as this doodling robotic arm. You can even find servos that can rotate all the way around. These are known as continuous servos, and while you can set their speed, you can't set their position. To control something like my lamp, I attached the servo to the base with a hose clamp and some zip ties. I wrapped a paperclip around the chain and connected it to the servo's lever arm. Now, when I press the B button, followed by the A button on my microbit, the lamp will turn on or off. In order to turn this into some kind of alarm clock, you would need to have the microbit know the current time, and then toggle the light whenever it's time to wake up. I'll leave that to you as a potential project idea. All the possibilities we can do with a servo motor is enough to make your head spin?